Hey everyone.
Hello, hello.
Welcome back.
It's been like half day now. I hope you guys are enjoying the sessions. And it's time for the next one. So our next speaker is Stefan Nikolic from Providus Technologies. Actually, Stefan is going to talk. Actually, you know what? I'm not going to give the introduction because that title is golden. It's too big. That Stefan deserves to introduce this by himself. So I'm not going to talk
Okay.
about what he's going to do for his session. Let's just bring him in and let's see.
Hello,
Hello,
guys.
Stefan. Hi.
Hello.
Hey,
Thank you for
Stefan.
having me.
Yep. So, Stefan, how are you feeling? You good?
Yeah, feeling good.
You've
Ready to
attended a
go.
bit. Maybe you were enjoying the sessions before too.
Yeah,
So,
I listened to a
yeah.
couple.
Yeah.
Awesome.
It's kind of funny because this track has a lot of JavaScript in it. So now I guess we are just going to hand over to you. We will keep an eye on everything. So you can focus on your session. As for our viewers, well, leave your comments, leave your feedback and questions in the live chat, and we'll be sure to pick them up at the end. Right? Enjoy.
Stefan, up to
Okay.
you.
Thank you. Nikolic. I'm a software development team leader here in Providus. And something about me. So I come from Serbia. It's a wonderful country. I don't know if you like sports, you probably heard of Novak Djokovic. He's a countryman. Or if you are using alternating current, you've probably heard of Nikola Tesla. Also, Serbia is famous for wonderful, beautiful nature and food. Also, something about me is that I like fishing. Also, enjoy playing games. And in the recent years, I started playing board games, and they overcome the playing games. Regarding my professional career, I started in 2012 in a company called Comptrade, working outsourcing for Hewlett Packard. So I worked on HP projects for like a year and a half. After that, I moved to Microsoft to their development center in Serbia. I was part of their office team there. I developed and worked on features for Word, OneNote, and Microsoft Sway. After Microsoft, I went back to my hometown to a company called Logispin. It was a gaming company, developing products for gaming industry. It developed for many brands. One of the brands that is most famous, probably you heard it also, is Bat Ninja. This is the first time I get to work on ReactJS, and my ReactJS career started there. After Logispin, I moved here to this beautiful country, Mauritius, and joined Providus. Providus is also into gaming industry and also developing projects for a lot of brands. And the most famous brand also here is Bat Ninja. So about Providus, this is a young company started here last year. We had like four developers in March. The company is fast growing. Currently, we have 20 plus engineers, and we have a goal to expand rapidly. We are currently in a beautiful big office that is, let's say, half empty because we plan to expand. So the goal is like to be 50 plus in next year or two. And maybe you notice we are located in Iben, in a first cyber city, and we are hiring rapidly, let's say. So I hope that you enjoy this presentation, that you like what we do, what you see, and that you will want to join our team. So now we can move on to the presentation. And I think that a lot of my colleagues were waiting for this moment, so it's too big. So I'm sure that for some of you, first thing that come to mind is, that's what she said. But in this case, that's what he said. And when I say he, I meant my boss when he saw the bundle size that we have. So as I mentioned, one of the brands we are doing is Bet Ninja. And I don't know how familiar you are with Bet Ninja, but it's one of the most used platforms for gaming. It's somewhere second, somewhere third by usage. So that means it has a lot of customers. And I don't know if you know this, but Bet Ninja also is located in Nigeria. So when front-end developers think about developing apps for Nigeria, first thing they think, slow internet. The second thing, old phones. And when you combine these two, you get what? A lot of loading time. And a lot of loading time leads to losing customers. So there were a lot of research done. I know that BBC claims that for every second, so the every second that their site loads longer, they lose 10% of their readers. Pinterest claims that when they decreased their load time by 40%, they gained 50% more in search engine traffic and signups. And also there was some research that has shown that 50% of customers expect the site to be loaded in less than 2 seconds. And if your site loads in more than 3 seconds, 40% of them are already left the site. So what are we going to talk today? Today we are going to talk about React, what it is, what are we using it, and we are going to talk about Webpack, how can it help with bundle size. Then we will mention a term called tree shaking, so one of the, let's say, practices to have a smaller bundle, then code splitting, lazy loading. Then we'll mention Preact. I don't know, it's becoming popular, I guess some of you have heard of it. Then we'll mention some Gzip, and Service Workers. So let's not lose time and continue. So first topic is React, or also known as ReactJS. There are other versions for native development, React Native, but we're just stick for ReactJS now. So it's an open source JavaScript library. It's developed by Facebook. It's a library that allows you to make component-based applications. So when I say component-based, I like to think of it like you having a building blocks like Lego or whatever, and you're building from small elements to bigger, and then joining that bigger elements and making a website finally. So what is the job of React? Its job is to render the data to the DOM, to the document object model. And just this is not enough to have a website. So with React, you usually have to use some additional libraries. For instance, we are using libraries. You need a library for state management, and you need a library for routing. So the two most popular are Redux and React Router. And yeah, so if you want to start with ReactJS, I would suggest you to start from ReactJS.org. The community is great about React. It's growing. It's more popular by day, and you should have it in your skill set. Let's just have a quick example of what is React. So you basically start with let's say empty web page, empty HTML. You there need to load your bundle, your code, your React application, and usually you have one element that will be host for the code that React will render in. And after that, you have a component. There are multiple ways to create a component in React. I will not go in deep here. This is one of them. And as you can see, it looks like a class, but then it renders an HTML, but it's not an HTML, it's JSX. So it's similar to HTML. You can use HTML tags for some, there are some exceptions for using attributes. But for instance, here you can see you don't put class, you put class name and similar. But also for JSX is interesting that you can put JavaScript code if you use brackets to surround it. So now this is something like a component that we created. So basically it's a div that has a header and it has some unordered list. So how can we make a website? So imagine that we created one more component like this, like header, or we created one more for footer, and then we can create four components that is our page that will combine all other components to a page. And then you can see that here we combined header, shopping list, and footer, and this will create another component. This could be a page, this could be a sub page. So basically, as I said, just like building blocks. Here in the last line, you will see this is a React command to render in DOM. If you remember the div that had ID root, with this command, running this function, we will put this page component inside the div with root as ID. And that's basically ReactJS. So if you want to learn more about it, you need to go research, practice, and it's not that difficult, just need to put time. Next thing that I would like to talk about is Webpack. So when you build that web application, let's say you have a bunch of files. For every component, you have a file. So you don't want, obviously, to import every file to your HTML. So there comes the bundling tool. So Webpack is a bundling tool. It has multiple purposes, not just to join several files in one. It also does some optimizations. For instance, it does minification that removes spaces, removes comments and stuff like this. Also does dead code elimination. So it has a smart way to decide to detecting the code that is not used and not to include it in the end product. Okay, I have a small demo to demonstrate this. So we go to here. So here we have, let's begin from the beginning. So here we have a index.html. This is a HTML5 site that just loads our main JS script. This is not a React application or anything. This is simple HTML with JavaScript. As you can see, we don't have any main.js script, so if you run it currently, the site will break. In our source files, we have index.js. This is some dummy script that we use for this test. So here you see we have like three simple and similar functions, byshirt, bypants, byhat. Every of them returns an object that has a type and amount different. And then we have a function selectClose that receives the type, and then if the type is shirt, then it returns by shirt, else returns by pants, and then it has by hat. Probably you notice that this by hat will never execute because we have if return and else return will exit the function. So basically this by hat is a dead code. And then we have selectClose shirt. Now we can start and build our using Webpack. Build our main. We have a warning that we did not select the production, so by default they select the production for us. And now, as you can see, we have a main here. But here, okay, let me wrap it. If you look at this bunch of code, it's a lot, but it doesn't look like our code at all. And there is a reason for this. Webpack noticed deducted that this code, if you include it in your website, it will do no effect on it. So basically, it will define the functions, run this function will return an object, and this object will not be used. So basically, this code will be run, but neither will you see it, neither the console log will see it, nobody will see it. So that's why here you don't see anything that looks like the code that you wrote. So how we can change this? Okay, let's comment this line. Let's uncomment these two lines. So basically, now we call the same function, but we keep the result, and then we console log the result. So now this function actually affects our website. And now if we run the same command, now we see that our bundle was 930, now is 1 kilobyte. And if we go to our index, to our main and log it, this, now you can see something that looks like the functions that we wrote. So basically we have something here, shirt, pants, but I don't see any hat. So basically, Webpack deducted that this function is never called. And also, because it's never called, this function doesn't need to be defined. And Webpack removed this for us. And that way we have less code. If we compare now the sizes, so if we go here, so basically, Webpack by default put some code that help Webpack to zip this and to make it smaller. So that's why the initial bundle size for Webpack is 930 bytes. If we check the main file we got here, it has, let's check, it has 1026 bytes. So let's say it gained 100 bytes by including this file. And if we go to this file itself, it's 400 bytes. So basically, file of 400 bytes was crammed into this Webpack by just adding 100 bytes. So you can imagine if you have a lot of files, you will save a lot of space, and the initial 930 bytes that comes with Webpack will be insignificant. And you can also notice that there are no comments from this code, so neither this one comment and everything. So that would be the demo that I had prepared for the Webpack. Of course, if you want to start with Webpack, I suggest you to go to the official webpack.js.org website. Now, when we're talking about the bundle size and everything, the thing that we need to say is the one tool that I found very useful, and it's Webpack's bundle analyzer. So basically, it's a library that you can easily install, and you have a graphical representation of your bundle and how much is every library, how much is it parsed, how much is it in gzip side and stuff like this. So here you can see, and maybe you loaded something that is too big and you don't need it, and you can remove it and find some lightweight alternative, or maybe you just need this library, but not everything, but some module. In that case, we come to the term tree shaking. So basically, I like to imagine it like library is a tree and it has its leaves, and every leaf is some feature from that library. And it's a bad practice that you import whole library even you need just some stuff. So you just shake the tree and take the things that you need. So instead of, let's say, importing Lodash, the whole thing, when you just need a find and throttle, this will save you a lot of time. Webpack will see that you import just find and throttle. It will find these two functions. It will find the functions that depend on this function. And it will import just the code that it needs, nothing more, nothing less. So import just what you need and keep it small. Next thing that I want to talk about is code splitting and lazy loading. And it is what it sounds like. When you talk about code splitting, you need to talk about lazy loading. Instead of having one big bundle, you can have multiple. Imagine you coming to a login page, and then you have also the code for 10 other pages that are available only when you successfully log in. So you can do this by using code splitting and lazy loading techniques. Basically, Vecpack can also pack and split your bundle in chunks so they are lazy load. And this is not something that is new and that is this is familiar for a long time. Gmail did this in 2009. So it's old, but it's often forgotten, and it can be useful in some cases. So also React allows us with some simple code to lazy load some components. This is a simple example that you import lazy and suspense from React. Then you can use suspense with a fallback. So this is what will be shown until you, while you don't have your component loaded. When the component is lazy load, the fallback component will be replaced with a component inside suspense. So it's very straightforward. Try it once and you will know it. And as I said, Vecpack helped us with this. In Vecpack 1, we needed to use require and share to the code splitting. And in Vecpack 2.2 and plus, we use import. And for this also, I have a small demo. Here, okay, let's see. We have an empty dist folder. In the source folder, we have three files. We have A, that is a simple function that says hi from A. We have B, that's similar to A, just say hi to B from B. And then we have an index that is entry point for our application. It imports synchronously A from A, and then it imports using import that we mentioned for asynchronous loading. And this import returns a promise that when it's loaded, it will execute the code below. So it will execute the default from B, or it will write to console hi from B. So this is a simplified version of your code. Now we have a command that we can run. And simple command, you can find it anywhere when you do this. So you need to put what is your entry file, output path, output file name, pattern, output chunk part name. So this will be the name of the main file. The other will be the name of the, let's say, children. And then you have output public path. So when you run this, you will notice that Vecpack has produced two files. You see here one hashname.js and hashname async.js. And if you look here, you can see the one that is the main. And if we now wrap it, you can see here it contains hi from A, but we don't find hi from B. Why is this? Because we said that we will lazy load the B when we need it. And when we need it, this file will be downloaded and imported. And as you can see here, we can see the hi from B code function. And that's basically it. These stuff are easy to use, just don't forget them. Okay, let's go next. Next thing is the preact. I don't know if you heard about it, but preact, or as I heard, it's performant React. So performant React, it's a lightweight version of React, and its core is like 4 kilobytes, and it's mostly compatible with React. So you can easily switch from your Preact from your React application to your Preact application. Of course, the keyword here is mostly, so not all stuff are supported. That's why they also have a disclaimer that there are some stuff that are not supported. But for the stuff that are not supported, you usually have something else that to replace it. For instance, you cannot use React Router with Preact, but you can use Preact Router. So there is that library. And also for other things that are not supported, you can, if you include the library Preact Compat, you can have React compatibility. So not just using Preact, you use Preact Compat and you have React compatibility. So as I said, lightweight, that means that something is missing. So what is missing? As they said, they're missing the prop type validation. They don't have it in Preact core, but if you use Preact Compat, you will have it. It's fully supported, as you see. Also the children, so React children is not supported in Preact, but you can reach children from its props. But if you include Preact Compat in your application, you will have full support for React children. And for synthetic events, Preact uses browser add event listener. So as you can see, not much stuff is missing, but it's very, very fast. So I researched, when I researched Preact, I found the results that were showing great improvements in React, in Preact when switching from Preact to React. Of course, development is another thing because community of React is much bigger than Preact, but Preact is getting there. So in time, I think more and more applications will switch to Preact. When we talk about bundle size, of course, we have to do some tests. So if you create a Hello World application, these are the sizes that you find. So Preact is like over, is like 8 kilobytes. React is 125, and I insert also Vue. It is also lightweight. It's 64 kilobytes. For some, let's say, application that require a little bit more, for to-do list, it was 15 kilobytes for Preact, Vue was 72, and React 131. And when I say the community is not as big as React, it doesn't mean that it's small. A lot of big companies are switching and have switched to Preact completely. First thing that I heard that switched was Uber. They switched and they made the application. Their application was less than 50 kilobytes for Uber, for their users. Also, you can see here Lyft, Pepsi, New York Times. A lot of companies are switching and there is a much bigger list. I didn't want to put everything here. If you want to start with Preact, you should go to preactjs.com and start from there. And let's say good luck. Now, next things, not so, let's say, related to the bundle size, but also for the other static content. Gzip, this is the thing that is also forgotten to be done on the server side of the product. So let's say you are hosting a website and hosting all the images and everything. You should set up that your server sends data compressed or gzipped. So with just adding a few lines of code in your htaccess file, it will work. If you're having a patch, you have different line, but very similar. If you're using Nginx, again, several lines of code, and your server now will send to the browser gzipped files. So this is all well known, but very often forgotten. And instead of sending 21 kilobytes, you send 5. Instead of sending 135 kilobytes minified file, you send 35. So you can save a lot of time on just doing a little tweaks to your projects. And the next topic that I want to mention is service workers. I know that in the previous presentations also other speakers talk about this, and they should, because it is important. It's also, let's say, relatively new. It doesn't affect the bundle size, but it affects user experience. So this is something that you can do to make your users have better experience while using your website. So what is a service worker? It's a web worker. And when you say web worker, it's a JavaScript file that you provide, you can provide along your website. And this is a JavaScript that runs separately from the main browser thread. And it can do some nice things. One of the things that it can do, it can intercept network requests. So basically, you can make a network proxy that lets you control stuff. Then, because it can intercept network requests, it's only supported over HTTPS. So to prevent vulnerabilities and attacks like man-in-the-middle attack, stuff like this. Then what it can also do, it can cache stuff, read and write to the cache. And later in the example, you'll see how good this could be. Also, you can deliver push notifications and stuff. With service workers, there has been a new approach. It's called, you heard of probably mobile first, but now there is also offline first approach. So basically, when you're developing your application, you should start from offline first. So basically developing how your website works when the user doesn't have internet. It sounds futuristic for me still. So as I said, it's relatively new. It's not fully supported. For instance, for Android stock browsers, it's partially supported. It's supported fully on Chrome from version 45, that was in 2015, Firefox 44, that was also for 2015. On mobile phones, for which I think that there will be more benefit, it's supported in Chrome from 84, and it was released in July this year. So in Android Fox, it was released in March 2018. When deploying your service worker, there are phases. First, there are three steps. First step is you need to register your service worker. Then when you register it, it can be installed. And when it's installed, it could be activated and running. So simple example, short example. As I said, it's a JavaScript file, and first, what you need to do is register your worker with three lines of code. And if the service worker is supported in the browser, it will be registered. Then when it's registered, it can be installed. Then you write a few lines of code to install your service worker. And here, what it say, hey, add to the cache these files. So basically, that add this SVG. And add this HTML page here, defined offline page HTML. And last step is using one of the features. So one of the feature is controlling your network. And here, for instance, if you create a GET request for the page and you get an error or no response, this means that your user doesn't have an internet. And in that case, if an error occurs, you will return from cache your offline web page. And then instead of user getting unable to connect, he will get your web page that was cached previously. And a lot of stuff, you can make your own game that to make user play the game until it gets internet or stuff like this. Stuff that you can do with this is create an application, and whenever user makes a request that needs internet, you can cache that request, and when the user gets online, you can call it. So basically, don't lose user input. So this is all that I had to talk about today. I wanted to mention stuff that I learned during research, how to make our applications better and everything. And I would like to thank you, the organizers, for organizing this event, everything. Of course, Providus for allowing to spend time and create this application and invest everything. I would suggest you to go to our website. If you like what you see, you can join our little family. Come with us, hang out and everything. You can go to Providus MU, see everything, go to careers, see the current open positions. As I said, we are hiring a lot, so feel free to drop your CV and hope you join our team. And that's it from me.
Hey, we're back. Yeah. Thank you so much, Stefan. That was a very interesting presentation.
Thank you very much.
So, Vidush, did you pick up any questions on the YouTube chat?
Yes, actually, I've been monitoring the YouTube chat, but no questions so far. But
that's
personally,
good. Interesting. Then everything I understand. Everything.
Full clarity.
Thank you very much.
On my side, I'd be sure to check out Preact, I guess that's how it's pronounced.
Yeah,
Preact. I'm sure there are some trade-offs though when you move to Preact instead of React. There should be, maybe that needs to be taken into consideration as well. But I've never used it before, so I can't say
yet. I use it, and I can tell you that I didn't find any difference noticeable. It used Preact router, not React router, and it was similar code. It needs some code changes for the routing, but it's like a 15-minute job to switch from one to another. But other than that, I suggest to use it. Only thing that I said is that the community is better for React because it's, let's say, older and bigger. But what you can do is develop your application in React, and at the end, just switch to Preact. So this is also
true.
Okay,
so on our side, if we don't have any questions, I guess we can wrap up the session. Stefan, do you want to leave any closing notes?
No, I just want to say bye to all my friends, family, and I know that a lot of Serbians are watching now.
Awesome.
All right. Well done, Providus. This just in the comments. Okay then. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the opportunity. See you guys.
See you.
Till next time. Bye.
Till next time, of course.